Mine, I'm just going to scream until the point we need to start talking.
Okay.
BRB UK. Worst teeth, better accents.
Hello, hello, and indeed, ahoy, hoy. Coleman is having a crisis. I'm Dan. This is episode BRB UK 551. Tim's also here.
Mm-hmm.
For those of you watching on video, I need to address the elephant in the room.
There's an elephant in the room again.
Yeah, an elephant. Coleman, why have you come dressed as Vice City?
Hi. So I had a summer social party at work a couple of weeks ago, and it was Halloween themed.
You haven't changed shirts since?
Hawaiian themed. It was Hawaiian themed, and then I decided rather than wear one of my many Hawaiian shirts that I tend to wear at work anyway, I wanted to pick up a movie one, and I tried to get Dennis Nedry's from Jurassic Park, but I couldn't get it delivered in time. So I got the next best thing, which is Magnum P.I.'s shirt, Tom Selleck's shirt from the hit TV show.
Does he want it back?
No, it's mine now. It doesn't fit him anymore.
Oh,
he's
okay.
Old,
how did you acquire it from? Did you fight him to the death using the medium of tiddlywinks or what?
We
exactly?
had a stash off.
Did you?
Yes.
He's got quite a formidable tash.
I was going to say, you should have shaved the rest of your beard and just left the stash just to complete the look.
I thought about that, but the last time I tried that, I looked like I shouldn't be allowed within 5 meters of a school.
I mean, the shirt's doing a lot of heavy lifting there, mate, in all fairness.
But yes, so I wore this and then I haven't worn it since, and then I had it washed up and hanging up. And just before the show, so it's quite warm in this room. I could do with something airy and light. So I thought, oh, Hawaiian shirt. Magnum PI time, baby.
It is nice. Big and red
TV
as well.
Show
so it's
I
kind
have never
of on
seen.
Brand. Really?
Yeah, there's that.
Okay.
Yes, never seen it.
Oh.
So again, Tim's come dressed as 1994. Hello, Tim.
Hello. Oh.
96, actually.
No, it's 1994.
Does say 94.
1994 is when it released in Japan,
oh.
Young man.
Dang.
Yes.
Yeah.
Shoot. Well, I
get
never.
Your facts right.
What incarnation?
Indeed. I, however, have come dressed as Dan in the office circa
now.
2023.
I mean, you are in it's fitting that you're in the office.
I know. See, that you know, it has many levels. Many, many levels.
Many levels, like an onion.
So we've got movies, TV, and games. There you go. We've covered all bases.
We did it.
Transmedia is what we are.
We did it, guys. Well, we hope you enjoyed this episode of BRB UK. We'll be back next week.
See you later.
Maybe talk about some video games.
Nah. Nah. I mean, I have to say, I would love to have to say that I've had lots of time to play video games. I wasn't here last week. My apologies. Having to adult sucks, man.
Oh, I love it.
Lots of work, trying to remortgage your house, contemplating whether or not I need another kidney.
It's a bad time to remortgage, Dan.
Whether or not I should just sell one of them. It is. It is. It's a bloody terrible time to remortgage. But Santander, mortgage providers, they didn't let me re-up my mortgage until 3 months before. So the earliest I could do it is like literally now because it's up in October. So it's like, hi, we have tailor-made the worst possible moment for you to do a mortgage. Congratulations. You didn't like having money, did you? Good. No. Fantastic.
Sounds good. Well, we hope you've enjoyed this episode of BRB UK. We'll be back next week.
Well, the problem is if I wait it out, young Timothy, then they put me on the Jeremy Hunt wants to come round your house and do trouble you round your back passage rate that's about 4,000,000%.
Yes, I'm not saying you want to wait out until it runs out, but you might not want to do it.
Oh no,
I'm
going to try and wait it out for 2 months.
Yeah. That's probably sensible, I would imagine at the moment.
Ah, welcome to BRB Midlife Crisis. It's a great show. It's a great show. I did, however, attempt to avoid the daily grind by engaging in several other actual grinds, like Diablo. That had a patch come out that absolutely made the game miserable. Basically, it was like, hi, we heard you're having fun. We've nerfed everything. See you later, bye! Which was a bit of a shame.
That was good, because the day that I was kind of hovering over going, maybe I should just bite the bullet and pick up Diablo. I'm sure I can find the time to play at some point. And everyone just started complaining about it. Went, oh, maybe hold fire a little bit.
Oh, Maybe not.
I mean, so season one of Diablo 4, so this is technically season zero, I guess. Season one literally went live as we started recording, so I haven't dabbled in that. So the seasons in Diablo are, you know, every season you roll a new character, ideally a new class, just to mix it up if you want to have some fun. And there's like seasonal specific items and, you know, very purposefully broken game mechanics for that season, just so you can have a bit of a laugh whilst slaying undead things. So, yeah, I'll be checking that out in time for next week. And then,
what's the mechanic for season one?
There are dead things with malignant hearts. You need to take their hearts, and you then smush the hearts into your belongings to imbue them with power, both positive and negative, in order to get some balance in the game mechanics.
Okay.
It looks fun. It looks fun. I mean, to be honest, I haven't had enough brain space in order to actually digest the 40 million pages of patch notes that came along with it. But I'll play it. That's how I'm going to tell if it's fun. Another seasonal event dropped in Destiny as well. That's been recycled. It's the Solstice event. Pretty much the same as the previous 3 years, except now you can't use your sparrows to get about quickly, so it's marginally less fun.
Okay.
As you can tell, I'm feeling like an old grumpy old man this week. And do you know what didn't make
it
better?
They nerfed my games.
Do you know what did make it better? Do you know, I was all excited. I thought I'm going to be a time trap, an alternate dimension, spacey, shooty dinosaur man by playing Exoprimal, now available on Game Pass. Man, am I glad that is a game that's on a subscription service as opposed to paying 70 quid for it.
I mean, you said you're a dinosaur man. You're more of a dinosaur shooting man, no?
A bit of both.
I thought about re-upping my subscription just for that because the Sea of Thieves Monkey Island expansion is on its way. I think that's got to be very soon now. And then I remembered,
I saw someone talking about that on Steam.
Yeah, I was like, oh wait, I bought that on Steam like 2 weeks ago so I could play it on my Steam Deck and then completely forgot about it. So I'm not resubscribing just for Exoprimal.
No, I wouldn't. I mean, I'm not going to go into it in too much depth. I mean, I think you should.
Really,
what are the menus like, Dan? How many teeth are in a T-Rex's mouth?
I mean, there are several menus. Menu the first, customize your hair.
Ooh.
There are seven choices, if memory serves, of hair.
And then you get into the
colors of your hair, which
Still
you can set independently from the color of your facial hair, which also has seven choices. And they range from the mustache to the mutton chops to the just lightly unshaven. Would you like me to continue?
No, I'm good.
I mean,
it was a joke until you started going through it.
Yeah.
I mean, Tim, I'm sorry. I'm encroaching on your thing.
You didn't describe menus at all. You described options. It's no good.
Got you there.
Not a good description of a menu.
Menu's
just a gussied up option.
It is. I don't know. I think Exoprimal is... So the setup is... There is... God, what is the setup?
Dinosaurs.
Right.
There's some sort of temporal anomaly or some description.
There's a temporal anomaly where different parallel timelines are going on with one another. And for some reasons, there's dinosaurs.
Draining dinosaurs.
You've got to kill dinosaurs to... kill dinosaurs to restore the timeline because dinosaurs. And sometimes, if you want, you can become a dinosaur and go into another timeline and eat people as a dinosaur. Because why? That's right.
Didn't know that.
Dinosaurs. It's a very over the top, very silly thing that actually, I suppose there could be a glimmer of some nuanced storytelling in there, but it's chocked to the brim of, you know, cultural stereotypes in a true Japanese action game way, which slightly, I don't know, perhaps I'm just old and grumpy, slightly turned me off.
You are old and grumpy, to be fair.
Yep. There is a very Eastern European lady. There's a very nerdy bloke who's nerdy and has glasses.
Right. Oh.
And there is a slightly, perhaps, over-the-top Haitian guy. Haitian, he's from Haiti, whichever the correct way of saying
Haitian.
That is. Haitian. There we go.
Yes.
And man, they've really lent into the cultural stereotypes there as well, in a way that makes me feel slightly uncomfortable. So
that's fair. But I kind of like the I kind of like playing those Japanese games where you got the weird translations and stuff and all the stereotypes and things, because it's kind of like hey, I feel like I'm watching a film from the 80s, and I like it.
Yeah. Well, I mean...
Says the man dressed as Magnum P.I.
Yeah, I mean, so there's lots of dinosaurs. Basically, lots of dinosaurs are coming out of temporal rifts left, right, and centre. You are facing off against another team in an adjacent but alternate time bubble.
Right.
And for reasons that involve, you guessed it, dinosaurs. You are racing one another to clear PvE objectives before it descends into a bit of PvP madness.
Gotcha.
Okay.
I dislike PvP because it makes me grumpy.
It burns
I'm an old
PvP.
Man. I have the reflexes of a doorknob.
New Year's
and I have absolutely no interest in doing PvP stuff. But anyway, there's lots of dinosaurs. There's quite a variety of dinosaurs, but they all feel very similar to shooting the face. So it all gets a bit tedious.
Oh.
There's lots of classes. Some of them are annoying.
Dino
I don't see how you mess up mechs versus dinosaurs. That sounds like something
you
that
just somehow,
shouldn't go wrong.
Somehow, mate, they've managed it, all right? So I don't know how they've done it. They've managed to make it deeply tedious. There's a bit of a, I don't know, it's all a science experiment. There's a little bit of kind of evil GLaDOS-esque experiment running AI to kind of go, oh, look, aren't we self-aware about how AI can change things? But it's all a little bit ham-fisted. It feels a bit, you know, a little bit derivative. It has sparks of perhaps being interesting with its PvEVP thing. PvEVP.
MMO.
I don't know. It just feels just a bit half-baked. It would be a good... If it was free-to-play, I could see why people might get engaged with it. It may as well be free-to-play because the microtransactions in it are frankly egregious.
Ooh, yeah, that's what we were talking about with Nikita Bladepoint, because that's just gone free-to-play, and I was saying that I was surprised it wasn't a free-to-play to begin with, because when you open it up and it's just like just menus and microtransactions
menus,
and currencies. Oh, menus! Love a menu! That's kind
Why
of...
Why has he become Welsh?
I don't
know. Tim Hibbs.
I think I just turned Welsh when I'm excited. I think, but yeah, when because I got excited for this because
you let out a little leak as well.
I don't want to see your Welsh face.
I got very excited when Exoprimal was announced because it was something new and it had dinosaurs and you can shoot them. I just want to shoot dinosaurs with my friends, damn it.
That's the thing. If it was just involved me shooting dinosaurs with my friends, I'd be on board. It's when you bring the great unwashed into my chuffing game and I've got to race against time that I get all grumpy.
Well, you
I don't want to do that. I just want to sit there and shoot dinosaurs in the face with Jamie and Kev. I'll have a nice relaxing time rather than competing against dickheads from other corners of the internet. Thank you very much. I've had a long week.
The last time they showed off their preview for the game and I just saw menus and microtransactions and things, I was like, oh, this looks like a free-to-play shooter. I don't want to play this. And I definitely don't want to pay money for it.
I did speak to a friend of the show, Kev, this week. We recorded an episode of VRB, which we recorded before this episode, but will be out after this episode for reasons.
VRB, available on all podcast platforms.
The reasons are, Tim, because, quote, Tim talked for never about menus.
Oh.
But Kev did say that he'd been playing it with you.
Tune in, VRB
and,
will be a wild ride.
Smash Soul, and basically he said that, I think he said that Jamie really liked it, he was somewhere in the middle, and you didn't like it very much, basically. Is that fair? Have I got that the right way around from memory?
I think that's absolutely fair. And I think you'll notice the gradation of excitement is pretty much exactly aligned with
age
in this case. Jamie has reflexes and is quite good at shooty things. Kev is slightly younger than me.
Good.
Has reflexes, and because he's been brought up on a diet of moderately hardcore RPGs, has a great more tolerance for tedium than I do. I was like, I've got an hour of fun time. I want to enjoy myself. Oh, wait, I'm not having fun. Can we go and play Diablo, please?
I mean, the problem with those games as well
is
if you're not... You really need, especially when it's four-player, multiplayer stuff and you have to band together and do objectives and stuff, you really need that kind of solid group of, you know, three friends to play with you that are going to get into it. Because I had the same thing with... what was it called? Rainbow Six Extraction. I actually really enjoyed that game, but trying to get a team of three people together with yourself and then play it. I think, was that 3-on-3 or was that 4-on-4? I can't remember. But
It's 4-on-4.
Yeah, right. So trying to get enough friends to play that game that actually enjoy it and didn't want to just sort of do it as a curiosity and then stop playing is very difficult. So I'd play that with randos and go, I'm just not having fun with randos because they don't play properly or they're literal children screaming.
With those sorts of games, though, I find it difficult to find time to play with a regular group regularly throughout the week before everyone gets really good at the game, and then I find that I'm too far behind the curve, so I don't want to pick it up later. Like, that's my problem with those sorts of things. It's difficult to fit it into things.
I think they're the kind of games, like things like kind of extraction shooters like Rainbow Six, and to a degree. It probably does quite well in playtests when everyone is laser-focused on playing the game in the manner that the designers intended. But when you let it out in the wild, people try and just take the shortest path to victory, irrespective of if it is fun for them or anyone else.
Right,
and that's probably what ruins it. There we go.
Also,
Dan's insight of the week.
It doesn't start with D, Dan. And I'm noticing a pattern on games you like to play with other people. Destiny, Diablo. And this is not doesn't start with D. So maybe it was called Dexoprimal, you'd be more down with it. Or Dinosaur Primal or something. Dino shoot in the face, or no?
Dan only likes games start with the same letter as his
name. Great catchy name. Ah, chaps, it's all right. I've saved the marketing strategy for this game. I'm going to call it Dino shoot in the face.
I mean,
good work, Tim.
It's not exactly like Exoprimal is a good name, is it, really? Like, I don't think that's a major part of its selling point, so, you know.
I don't know. It's on Game Pass. Consider it like a free-to-play game that isn't actually free-to-play, and I suppose you'll have fun.
I have downloaded it to my Xbox, but I haven't turned my Xbox on since, so I might play it at some point.
Whenever these games come out on Game Pass and Dan talks about them or I talk about them and Tim goes, I've downloaded it, assume Tim is never going to play it.
Quite possibly.
Have you launched Sea of Thieves yet, mate? Because you bloody should.
How was Nikita Bladepoint, Tim?
I downloaded that. Yeah, my Xbox. I'm not sure I've turned my Xbox
even
on
Game Pass
since
anymore.
I downloaded that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I'd say PS5 my now, Xbox is not getting a lot of use at the moment because I Game Pass everything on PC, and then other stuff, kind of the exclusives are kind of really more of a PlayStation thing. I don't know.
Well, between VR and getting more review stuff on PlayStation, like I tend to play my PlayStation a bit more, but that's partly because if a game's coming out on Game Pass day one, I'm less likely to put myself forward for a review code because I'm like, well, I can just play on Game Pass and we can talk about it on the show at a good time sort of thing. But yeah.
Well, talking of games you got for review, Tim, you got a game for review.
I did indeed.
Didn't you?
Fancy that.
Have you come up with a catchy name for it?
Absolute Stonker.
Absolute Stonker.
No. It's a stonker of a game, though. Name-wise, photo pathfinding game, maybe?
Right, okay.
But I think
maybe
that kind of alludes to
it, what it's actually called.
It's actually called Viewfinder. It's one I talked about in preview when I got to see it at WASD. I've been playing the full game this week. Haven't quite completed it. I think I'm on the final level where it kind of mixes things up a bit. And the final level is tricky, whereas the rest of the game was not as tricky as I'd been led to believe from the playing the preview.
So I was going to say, so fully uninitiated, what's the key mechanic then? Since Viewfinder makes me think I'm taking photos of stuff.
Well, and you are. And what you are doing with those photos is then manipulating the environment with that photo, and that photo changes your environment based on the view that you can see when you lay that photo on. So the classic example that you've seen and that they showed off in the preview and they've kind of showed in trailers and stuff is you take a photo of a bridge and then you use that photo of the bridge to bridge a gap between two areas. You put that photo in place and then the bridge is in that place, basically. So when you come to cross over, it's filled in the gap and you can just walk over. And that's kind of cool. Yeah, it's one of those things where seeing it in action kind of really informs like how it works, and it kind of it's an amazing thing every time it kind of works. The one thing I'll say overall with the puzzles is that a lot of the time it feels you get to an end of a level and you're like, I'm not sure if I solved that puzzle or if I broke that puzzle with the game's mechanics, and I'm not entirely sure the developer cared either way. So the example of that bridge thing, like you could take a photo of the bridge, but you could also take a photo of just a wall and use that to plug the gap, and it would allow you to walk across it and stuff like that.
So like you could like take a photo of a wall, tilt it, and then go, right, put the photo down there, and then that becomes a 3D object in the world. Okay, that's cool.
And the only kind of restriction on that is sometimes you are restricted by the geometry of the environment as to where you can place yourself in relation to the gap that you're filling or whatever it is that you're trying to manipulate. And so that can be difficult to actually physically put in the right place. Like, for instance, if you took a picture of a wall, it might be difficult to bridge a gap with that because you might not be able to get it at the right angle to properly fill the gap so that you can walk over it. And there is a jump button in the game. You can jump over things, but there's not supposed to be any like really taxing platforming going on. You really are supposed to be like solving the puzzle with doing it, but you can kind of break things and do things. So for instance, you could take a photo of something and then put it below you in the floor that would change the floor and you could drop down into that photo. And I say photo, but the game doesn't restrict itself to photos within the game. So there are other things. There are paintings that you can like walk into once you lay it out in front of you. There are
like Mario.
There's photos that you take. There's also photos that you find throughout the environment. There's also like a Tetris kind of thing where you can tilt out a load of Tetris pieces onto things in front of you. There's a Tamagotchi thing that you find at one point in the game. And then it makes a giant sort of thing in front of you, and then you can water the plant in the Tamagotchi to kind of get a little achievement there and stuff like that. And so, like, there's a lot going on. You can tell it's a kind of, for want of a better sentence, a gamer's game made for gamers. Like, it really does kind of play on,
a gamer's game made for gamers.
A gamer's game made for gamers. But it kind of plays up to, you know,
your perspective, sir.
Your knowledge of that.
Force your perspective, will you?
And like it's really well. The one thing that I think it did a bit better than it was indicated from the preview is it does a much better job of like onboarding you into the kind of concepts and the things that you're dealing with. So it makes some of the puzzles I saw in the preview, it like broke my brain trying to wrap my head around how like to get the photos and how to manipulate the environment, like taking photos of stairs so that you can then use those stairs to climb up to a pedestal to take a battery off it to then power one of the teleporters to get you out. And basically, you're always trying to get to a teleporter to get you out of the end of the level, and that's how you solve the puzzle. But getting to that teleporter can be tricky. Sometimes those teleporters need batteries, as I mentioned, to power them. They might need multiple batteries to power them so that you can then stand on the teleporter and exit the level. But it does a really good job of onboarding you, and some of the stuff it does to do that, like, for instance, to start with, you don't have your own camera. You find your camera partway through the game, but it will have either photos you can pick up in the environment and then you can place in certain places, so it's already kind of giving you the photo, or it's got a static camera where you can take a photo from a particular place, and then you know that that's the photo that you need to use somewhere in the environment, stuff like that. It also then mixes things up towards the end of the game where you might have a static camera and your own camera, and you have to use those in combinations. And one of the things it does with that is it has a timer-based thing going on. So you set the static camera off on a timer, walk in front of it and take a picture of yourself. And that has some interesting like teleportation kind of options going on. When you reveal the picture of yourself, it then teleports you that distance away from yourself. So there's some puzzles based around that mechanic as well. It's a really, really good puzzle game. It's generally like a pathfinding, puzzle solving type of game. And as I said, there are elements where it feels like you've totally broken the puzzle to kind of solve it, but it feels like it encourages you to do that in a good way as well. One of the major mechanics that makes the whole thing less frustrating and makes the whole thing work better as well is that it's got a rewind mechanic. So at any point in time, you can just hold the button down to rewind a random amount of time, but you can also just double tap the button to rewind to a certain point. And those certain markers will be like when you took a photo or when you used a photo in the environment. So you can always skip back. The only thing with that, if you accidentally skip back a bit too far, you can't go forward. You'll have to like solve that bit of the puzzle again. But, okay. You know, it's better than having to restart the whole level and having the frustration of doing that. That also makes it kind of free and easy to be experimental and to mess around with things and have fun with stuff. There's a load of like collectibles in the environment, and some of those don't always come from getting from like, you know, from one point to another to solve the path to get out of the puzzle area or to get to the teleport and stuff. Some of them will be a diversionary path that you can pick up the collectible and then rewind back to the level to then carry on the rest of the puzzle in the level. So anytime that you're doing any of the pathfinding puzzle solving, rewinding will undo that and you'll have to continue through the path. But if you get any of the collectibles, that's not undone by rewinding, basically. So a lot of the collectibles are kind of off the beaten path type thing. So you might wander into a painting to find one of the collectibles and stuff like that, basically. And the collectibles in the first level are ducks. So, hey. Yeah, that was on theme for me. And then there's various different other collectibles as you go through the game. I don't have a good handle on how long it took me to get through things. I kind of feel that I sailed through.
Can I introduce you to the concept of a watch?
Yeah. But I just didn't keep a good eye on the play sessions that I played. But I kind of feel that I got through it quicker than I thought I would from level to level, based on how much time it took me to get through some of the preview levels. And I don't know whether that was just a result of them doing better onboarding and kind of introducing me to the concepts. I also kind of got to cheat a bit, because some of the more difficult puzzles that I saw in that preview, I obviously knew the solution to when I came across them in the main game as well. So I managed to kind of sail through some of the sections a bit quicker than I might have done. The last level mixes things up a bit. Most of the game, it's quite kind of serene. There's quite a nice leisurely pace to it. The fact that you can rewind stuff is kind of thing. There's also a kind of hint mechanic, which I didn't actually know was there until like halfway through the game. I think I was on world, like there's five different like areas and then multiple different levels within that and then different sections of that level. So I was in the third area and I think level 6.3 before I found there was a hint system. And the hint system just pops up when you spent too long in one area or when it thinks you spent too long. And it kind of just says, would you like a hint? Go to the menu. So it doesn't, you don't have to go into
Dumbo.
It. you don't have to go into it. And the hint's not exactly, it doesn't exactly spell things out, but it does kind of just give you a little hint. But I like the way that it does that. It doesn't kind of shove it in your face. But it means you tend to not get stuck, and it's like there's a few things where it's like, oh, this level's breaking my brain trying to do it, but there's not like anything majorly taxing. When you get to the last level, it mixes things, what I assume is the last level from the layout of the game, but it kind of, I don't want to give too much away, but it's basically, it's against the time limit, and you can fudge that time limit, and there are ways and means around that a little bit, but it just feels like it's slightly different to the rest of the game, and I can understand it from a story's perspective. The thing I kind of equate it to is the last level in Halo, where you're racing in a warthog, okay, and it feels very different. For some reason, I loved that in Halo, and I don't like it quite as much in this. I think it does make it more of a challenge and more difficult, and it's a tricky level where you really need to learn the critical path through the whole thing, take the photos, make sure that you're taking photos at the right time and taking objects with you at the right time and all this type of stuff. But I kind of preferred the pacing of the rest of the game, and it feels like a bit jarring now that it's not kind of sitting alongside that, but not in a terrible way. And I really I really enjoyed my time with the rest of the game. It's a really interesting puzzle game. If you have any interest in puzzle games at all, this is a really high caliber game. As I said, it kind of feels like it's made for gamers, but also just does some really interesting things with change of perspective and stuff like that. And we've seen slightly similar things before, but nothing quite like it. And I really strongly recommend the game. As I said, I got a review code, so you might want to take it with a slight pinch of salt. But I was really looking forward to the game, and it really didn't disappoint. So, yeah, it's a very strong recommendation, especially if you like puzzle games, basically. So, yeah, it was really good.
It does look like an awesome game. It kind of You know, I quite like that, having to almost think in another dimension. But you got that a bit with Superliminal. I know it's not. Yes. I know it's similar, but not identical. Mechanic,
love that.
I really like those kind of lateral thinking puzzle games. But no, I'm very tempted to check this out, I have to say.
I was trying to remember the name of, there was a little game, was it Echochrome on the PSP, where it did the
like the MC Escher one?
Yes. And there is actually, you quite late on in the game, you get to an actual Escher drawing that you can kind of drop into, and that was kind of interesting. But it took a while to get to Escher, but it had some other touch points and stuff like that. And it's got like Wilhelm Scream and I did get my other half, who is an art teacher, to tell me the name of the other one, but I've completely forgotten. It's Pierre someone. But it's the colored squares, different colored squares, like in primary colors. And yeah, anyway, someone will know what I'm talking about. But anyway, yeah, so it was a really interesting game, really interesting mechanic. And as I said, nothing quite like it and worth checking out at some point.
Cool. Sounds good. I may well take you up on that offer.
Mm-hmm. And incidentally, I was playing on PS5, but I believe it's available on all major systems right now.
Well, those are all the games we done played, because all I've been playing is Dave the Diver and AEW Fight Forever.
Oh, I picked up Dave the Diver.
What do you think?
I haven't got that far into it
Pointless saying it.
I know. I just wanted to say. No, it's still interesting. The little bit I have played, I could really see myself liking it. I love the characters seem awesome. The art style's fantastic. I can see that being a major time sink. I've only just scratched the surface.
Is it on your deke?
But yeah, good recommendation.
You should dive into
it deeply. I'm playing it on the deke.
Yes. Told you. Shut up. Dan game. Good Dan game. Right, those are all the games we've done played, but we have headlines to get through. We've got Goodio Games News, just checking on the time, having a quick cursory glance at that. Yes, and we shall start off with the big news, because after 20 years of service over at Xbox, Larry Herb, better known as Major Nelson, is stepping down. He's going away from Xbox after two decades.
He has been kind of running their kind of comms. It feels like he's been running their comms or been the face of their social media for so very long. And he's kind of like everyone's favorite uncle of gaming, I kind of get the feeling. I mean, I know he's, for some, he's a bit of a divisive character, you know, depending whether you're Team Green or Team Blue, your fondness for him may differ. But he's always seemed to be a very community-focused bloke. And, you know, 20 years is a heck of a long time to do any job, let alone that one. And God knows you have to have a thick skin to be kind of in the front and centre of any gaming brand. So, you know, all the better for the future. And, you know, I've always been impressed with how knowledgeable he is about the kind of gaming culture, how well he knows his tech as well. And that's genuinely always seemed like a nice bloke to me. So, you know, good for him, and all the best for the future, I reckon.
Yeah, so if you didn't know, since he went on to the Xbox team in 2003, he contributed to many of the features of the 360 and Xbox Live, including the achievement system, cloud saves, party chat, and in-game messaging. And then he became the senior director of corporate communications in 2012. Yeah. And this is something I didn't know when I was trying to get some info on the guy. I didn't know that the name Major Nelson comes from Major Melson. I didn't know his gamertag came from I Dream of Genie.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. One of the characters, Major Nelson.
Oh. Mm. Yeah. There you go.
Oh, better than Seaman, anyway.
Yeah. Captain Pugwash was his other favourite. So.
Yeah. Has he still been doing his podcast? Because I did listen to it many years ago. I haven't listened to it for a few years.
Same.
I don't know if that's something he kept up with or not, but
I think he has. I think they're going to pause it, though, is unsurprisingly, while they put it on a little bit of a hiatus.
Okay. Yeah, I was the same. I heard him on an interview on whatever IGN's Xbox podcast was called at the time. And he was advertising his podcast, and I went, "Oh, I'll listen to that because this guy seems quite friendly and personable." And listened to that for a bit, but it was very kind of into the weeds of Xbox. I just want to know what people think of games, and they were like, "It was like a keynote sometimes when you're listening."
Yeah.
I'm okay. I'll have to leave this one alone.
He was a bit of an official mouthpiece, but I used to like him, and I think it was E, his co-host, and I can't remember the name of the lady that did it for a bit as well, but they had some good
Laura
chemistry.
Lollipop,
I believe. Yes, yes. But they had some good chemistry between them. It was a decent podcast. I enjoyed that. As I said, haven't listened for a few years. I don't know if that's something he was still doing, but I've heard good things from other people that know him in America and have met him, and he's always apparently been quite friendly to them and quite supportive and stuff, so... Yeah. Oh, also a chance to throw out some love for our UK equivalent as well in Mr. AC Bongos. He's always been a nice chap whenever I've come across
genuinely lovely bloke.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Godspeed, Major Nelson.
Mm-hmm. That was the biggest headline we've had this week. So a couple of little things. I thought this was quite interesting. So Bandai Namco have announced this week that they are retiring the Gundam Evolution game, which
already
It's only been out for a year.
Oh.
If you are currently playing this game, I believe that you won't be able to make any microtransactions for the premium currency in-game from the 26th of July. And then they're going to carry on with Season 6, which is meant to release in August 23rd. The final season following that will come out October 25th. And then the game itself will shut down in November 29th.
But so they're shutting down purchases in a week, give or take, when we're recording. So what if you've bought a bunch of crap for a game that's going to go away?
No refunds.
No refunds.
Yeah, no refunds.
Up, no refunds. Wow.
All sales are final, Dan.
What was the one we did this to recently? The what was that Warner Brothers fighting game called? I've forgotten the name of it already. Tim liked it.
Is that the one that had like Shaggy and everyone in
really made an impression on us, clearly.
Yeah.
Multiversus.
That was it.
Yeah. They did the same because they haven't shut the game down, but they went, oh, by the way, this was in beta the whole time and we've taken
it. Yeah, we're on pause now.
We'll bring it back. We'll bring it back when it's done.
Early 2024, they're bringing that back.
Yeah, but then they went, hey, any microtransactions that you may have bought, tough.
Wow. Like, not rolling them forward at all.
Well, I don't know if they're rolling forward or what's going on with that, because they might retool that game into being like a full purchase, get all your characters, rather than the weird free-to-play system that they've gone for. But yeah, if you made purchases,
I would
you don't
prefer
get any
that.
Fun on that. But that's the same here. It's a bit of a shame. If a game doesn't last a year, I think there should be some refunds on that of some form or another. But if you have currency purchased, and you will still be able to buy items and stuff. You'll still be able to spend it, but you won't be able to get any refunds.
That's nice of them, isn't it?
Mm. Was this put forward as a live service game as well?
Yes, it was a multiplayer online shooter, free to play, I believe.
But I think, yeah, like you say, if it's a live service type game, there should be a minimum period of support, basically.
Tim's on the verge of writing a letter to his MP, I can tell.
The issue I had with this was we were constantly getting barraged with PR emails about this Gundam Evolution game, and I went, fine, I'll give it a go. They went, oh, no, you can't in the UK. It's US only at the minute. I thought, well, stuff your game. I don't want to play it. I kind of did, but now I don't. Mainly looking for
fun. What a fickle man you are, Coleman. What a fickle man.
I get upset easily, apparently. So, lastly, we've got rumors of, thanks to one of the Last of Us composers who also had a role in The Last of Us Part 2, that is Gustavo Santaolalla?
That's easy for you to say.
It's definitely not. Apologies
Gustavo Santaolalla, I want to say.
Santaolalla?
Yeah, I like that pronunciation.
Santaolalla?
Olalala.
Lala?
Yes,
no problem. I would say the last part of it is
Olalla.
Okay.
Santaolalla.
I would guess.
So we have Lala, we have Olalia, and we have
Lala and Poe.
Should we just call him Gus?
Yeah.
Gus.
So,
all right, Gus.
Gus Danto. Gus Danto, he said he was doing one of those videos on the blender and they were talking about his cameo appearance in Last of Us Part 2, because you can see him as a survivor playing banjo in that game, I believe.
Oh,
and he said that his
Kazoon
character will be getting an expanded role in new versions of the game, hinting that there will be new versions of the game and new songs in the game soundtrack. And that's interesting because we've had the PS4 version, we've had the PC version. people have been wondering why there isn't a PS5 version, and we had been told it's because the game plays so the PS4 version plays so well on the PS5. Why would you need a PS5 version?
Thanks, marketing.
Yeah. Same reason Division 2 doesn't have a PS5 version. But it looks like we might be getting a PS5 version if the rumors are to be believed. Mm-hmm. And PlayStation game, that means rather than get a free upgrade for your PS5, you'll have to pay £30 or something for an upgrade.
Thanks, marketing.
I love the PS5 system. Mm-hmm. Right, that is all the news we have time for this week.
Oh, good.
There was pretty more news on the whole Xbox Activision Blizzard King thing, but it was pretty boring.
That's why it's not in the agenda.
Stuff and other stuff, pretty dull.
Is corporate deliberations taking a long and slightly tedious amount of time? Is that the news, Tim?
But it does seem to be that it's going to be resolved in the next month or so by most people's estimations, and that kind of fit in with what
by
we
hook
did
or
say
by
about
crook.
It a few months ago, so yeah.
By stick or by dick.
By nickel or by back. By rhubarb or custard.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
By Bobby or by Kotick.
By scorpion riding on the back of a frog. What are we talking about?
Nice. I have absolutely no idea anymore.
Shall we wrap up?
Let's do that.
I'm melting in this room.
Oh.
Yeah. Cool. All right. So, if you want to buy things with my face on it, you should go to tpublic.com/stores/BRB. There are things that don't have my face on them, but they are all inferior bits of merchandise.
Which you should still buy.
You should still buy, but only in conjunction with things with my face on it.
This is not a successful sales tactic, I'd like to point out, Dan. I think we should possibly
stuff with my face on it.
Banish your face from the store.
No!
You know, if I had disposable income, I would every payday go over to tpublic.com/stores/BRB and pick out a new t-shirt each payday and buy that. I just keep that going until I have filled out my collection.
I'm
going
to try and get some new t-shirt designs up there in the next month. I have been trying, but work has had other ideas, but hey.
Well, we have new t-shirts to do with the likes of Tabletop Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
We've already got a pretty good Tabletop
Tuesday one, but hey.
Well, I want another one.
Speaking of good Tabletop Tuesdays, anyone doesn't know, each and every Tuesday we do an event at the Loading Bar in Stoke, Newington. Most weeks we have
Tuesday, never heard of it.
We have a feature game, and if you play that feature game that evening, you have a chance of winning a copy of the game at the end of the evening. This week's event was really nice. It's always nice when we have a full house, which, you know, is only beaten by a flush and five of a kind. But yeah, we had every table in the bar with people on it. There were people playing Warhammer 40K. There were people playing Magic. And generally, lots of other people playing board and card games.
D&D.
At one point in the evening, there was only two people in the bar that weren't playing board or card games or a tabletop game of some description. They were playing Mario Kart. So I
beat them to beat them up. You told them they're uncool people and they are banished from the land.
They had played, those two people had played other board and card games throughout the evening. So I was okay with that. They had a bit of a break and played Mario Kart. That's acceptable behavior in a video game themed bar where we do a board game evening. But also, yeah, this week, right now, this one's a bit complicated. I booked in our first guest in a while.
God.
It's been organized for a while. We're doing a game called Connecting London. My only problem is, ironically, it's a game about traveling around London. And there is a rail strike scheduled for the whole of this week. I think it's a rail and tube strike to make it even worse.
Reminder.
Yeah. So I've kind of reached out to the guest and said, if you want to reschedule, we might need to reschedule. So that there's a slight caveat that we might need to do that. But I also know that said guest is currently on holiday. So I know I may not get an answer till the last minute. So I might have to cancel it at the last minute. But if all goes to plan, we have a guest booked in for this week. We have a guest booked in for the week after. So there's definitely going to be one guest or two. If I do have to reschedule at the last minute, I will substitute in a mystery game at the last minute like I did for this week. But that means that you will get a game and some extra prizes to make up for it. So it's not a bad thing. If that sounds like something you want to be interested in, there are more details on the top left-hand corner of bigredbarrel.com. And you can search Meetup Group and search the search for Tabletop Tuesday and join the over 2,000 people that hopefully won't join us next week. But generally, it'd be nice if some people can make it along to the bar. So come along and join us in the next couple of weeks. Got some great guests coming along and showing off their games. Best way to learn a board game is by not having to read the rules and by getting the designer of the game themselves to teach you the game. So Andrew Harmon's booked in for next week. And I'll be announcing next week's guest the week after. Just on that note as well, I didn't mention last week because we were running a bit long on time, but I did also pop along to Loading Bar in Brighton. So thank you very much for people that hosted us there. That was very nice. If you can't make it to London, but you can make it to Brighton, then it's worth going along there. They have a lot of board games and obviously video games as well, being Loading Bar. And some video game themed cocktails and other things and food that they have on there. So you could possibly pop along. They also have a really nice outside space on the beach in Brighton as well. So that's definitely worth heading down for at some point as well. So,
Just watch out for the floaty turds.
Well, the water in Britain, not so good anymore. But it's far enough from the beach that you're safe.
Have a seat and look at the beach rather than risk stepping on syringes.
Yep.
England beaches.
Goodness.
Tabletop Tuesday, every Tuesday over at the Loading Bar in Stoke, Newington. Be there to play video games. And if you can't make it because of the rail strike, let Tim know and he will pay for an Uber just for you. Well done.
You lucky folks.
Tim's booking a lot of Ubers.
That's not true.
And he'll upgrade you to an Uber exec as well. So you can get there comfortable, nicely refreshed, because Tim's a nice guy like that.
No, I'd actually recommend that Tim gets the e-Ubers, if he could. That'd be better for the environment.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Better for the environment.
Please, Tim. Make sure.
What a guy.
Yeah. Pay that little bit extra in the budget just to make sure.
Thanks, Tim.
Sometimes they're cheaper. But yeah. But also not paying for them.
Right. No, you are.
No, you said you were, Tim. Don't go. You can't say one thing and then take it back. All right. So if you, but you know, all right, I can answer you won't buy the meal, but you will buy everyone a drink though, right?
I mean, also no.
With tap water.
I'll get everyone a drink of tap water. Yeah. Free tap water.
Wow. So if you too want to enjoy the unbridled hospitality that Tim can offer at Tabletop Tuesdays.
Someone bought me a drink.
Grab your free pint of tap water.
Someone bought me a drink this week. That's a much preferable way round. Thank you very much.
Tap water? Was it your missus?
No. Also no. Oh. Someone that has enjoyed our events and just wanted to buy me a drink to say thank you because they're a nice person, unlike you two Herberts.
Wow.
I've bought you many drinks in our lifetime together.
You haven't bought me drinks. Throwing me under the bus, but throwing me under the Uber in getting everyone an Uber to the bar, that's not nice.
And buying them drinks. No. I remember once going to the old loading when it was in Dalston and noticing one of the barmaids there being really annoyed that there were two guys just hanging out on the bar and not ordering drinks, I can't remember what was really annoying them about these guys, but mainly just they were hanging about and just not buying anything.
Yeah.
And then I heard her openly complain about it and then went to the bar and went, hey, I've brought a packet of crisps for me. Could I have some hot water to make some broth? Get out. Fun times at Loading Bar. I miss winding people up there. Anyway, if you've enjoyed this show, then Lord help you. You've got some weird old taste, but we appreciate you listening. If you could be so kind as leaving us a podcast review on whatever podcast platform you're listening to us on, it could be Apple Podcasts, it could be Spotify, Stitcher, any of those podcast addicts, many of those platforms available, that usually gets back to us. We can read it in the show. We can judge you for your writing and spelling and grammar and things.
we'll give you notes on the grammatical quality of your review.
We will review your review.
Dan will do a dramatic reading of your review. That's a better prize. Also, I just wanted to note, if people can give us likes and love on YouTube, that'll be much appreciated, especially because we were robbed of a load of our views, as me and Coleman noticed last week and had a look at. We got like a good couple of thousand, which is good for us in our little YouTube circles, But then subsequent episodes, we got up to a good 500-600 views, and then they all got taken away, and we were down to like 50 or so. And so that makes us look bad.
Why?
You can make us look good again.
YouTube's
why?
That would be good. We've no idea why. Like, we did try and look behind the scenes and dig into things. I think just YouTube algorithm hates us. I think that's the answer. So you can help us fight
it's
the
funny
algorithm.
To encourage it.
We kept the likes, we kept the comments, we lost all the views, and we don't know why.
Yeah.
I haven't checked to see if they've come back. But anyway, yes, if you have enjoyed this show, apart from leaving us a review and leaving us a like, comment, subscribe on YouTube, as I was going to say in a bit, but Tim's ruined my flow, so I've got to work out how to get back to this. You can go and leave us questions and give us comments and feedback and all those kind of things over on bigredbarrel.com. Over there, we have a comment section. We have a link to our Discord. We have a Facebook, Twitter, and a Threads at Big Red Barrel. Ooh. And we also have a YouTube called Big Red Barrel TV, and of course links to all of those things are available in our show notes. So whatever way you're listening to this, scroll down in the show notes, there should be links to everything that I have just mentioned. Maybe not Threads, because I might not have added it into the show notes yet. I should learn to do that. This is I have to say it out loud, so when I'm editing I'll go, oh yeah, and put it
oh
in.
Yeah,
it's like,
I promise that.
Actually, the whole purpose of this podcast is Coleman just leaving notes for future Coleman. You know, several episodes, it's been like, we found out what he's going down the shops to buy later on that day. He's like, a packet of crisps, pint of milk.
This is Coleman's 12 monkeys, is what we're saying, basically. Yeah.
Yep.
That's why you're wearing that shirt.
Where?
Okay. Also, as we didn't get a question this week, or do we not have any questions in the show notes, can I ask a question?
I have been
a question
Coleman.
To ask.
I've been Dan.
It's a quick one.
Tim's a gibbering idiot. What? It's never going to be a quick one. All right, we'll
is
this
one. And I'm holding up the Hitman duck thing. Is it a Hitman duck? Or is it a Hit duck?
It's
not a man.
It's
a duck.
I would say it's a duck cosplaying as Hitman.
You think? Definitely got the barcode on the back of his head as well.
Yeah, but so have I.
I mean, that just makes it easy for them to feed the duck to the meat grinder so they can patch it up into tasty burgers and stuff.
If you scan the barcode on the back of Agent 47's head, do you know what it says?
Please go outside.
No, it's a pack of 24 smart price eggs.
Nice.
Yeah. Weird, isn't it?
Okay. Oh.
They are also pretty good at cosplaying Hitman, those eggs, I have to say.
Yes, we are.
Yes. Right. Or, yeah.
Me and my 23 brothers in a pack.
That is a terrifying mental image.
Imagine you just open a pack of eggs and there's
that is now
24 bits of Coleman's
a pack
head.
Of eggs, Jen, it's just full of, yeah, just full of Coleman burning at me.
I'm just going to open up the Photoshop AI system and go, just highlight the bottom half and go, turn into egg.
But do you have to put the voice in, turn into egg?
That is the AI voice. Whenever you command into AI, you have to say that. Hey, let's wrap up the show and go. I'm going to melt.
Take the show out the back and shoot it in the head.
Absolutely. So thank you for listening to this drivel. We apologize profusely, but you might be back next week for more. And if you are, good for you. That's what I
well
say.
Done.
Good for you. Good for you.
You've
way
got
to,
persistence.
Way to be a human.
Well done.
You have. Or you've just forgotten to cancel a subscription. I don't quite know. Anyway. We will be back next week in some shape or form. All that really remains is for me to remind you that I have been Dan.
I might have been Tim.
I've been egg-shaped chaos.
Egg-shaped chaos.
Mm-hmm.
Chaos. True chaos wouldn't have a shape.
Yes, it would.
I mean, no, if you crack that egg, it becomes
having a shape
again.
Implies there's some kind of order. And chaos is the absence of order.
That's why the shape is a Mobius strip with a cut in it.
What?
Because then it wouldn't be eternal. Chaotic, isn't it?
Yeah.
No.
Like 24 Coleman eggs.
That isn't
box.
Chaotic. That is chuffing, terrifying.
terrifying
take
image.
My brother instead. He's not called Coleman.
Take my brother, Bruce Willis, or Harry Hill, or Steve McFadden.
Wow. What?
Or Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Heck, want to see get AI to make an image
quick,
of 24
here,
different
Smith.
Bald
take
men
him.
In an egg in a box of eggs. That's what we want.
What? I'm not
it's
making
right,
this show
Fred
up.
In there.
Someone else can make it. I don't want to do
Fred.
This.
Take your questionable views about many things elsewhere.
And a right wing said Fred.
Wow. Jesus. It's web places. Right, we're going. We really should. So thank
Dynamite
you.
Dynamite drop in money. That broadcast school has really paid off.
Yep, certainly has. So thank you once again for listening to us. We'll be back next week. And until next time, dear listeners, toodle bye. I looked out the window, seeing this poor head. Ran through the fridge and pulled out an egg. Sculpted on my sculpts, he had no hair. Lost that shot, he was caught out there. Saw the convertible driving by. Loaded up the slingshot, let one fly. He went for his to find, he didn't have one. Put him in check, correct, my egg, your egg. You and your ears are quite welcome for the podcasting goodness that you just heard. Why not roll on over to BigRedBarrel.com for more podcasts, news, reviews, and videos from the biggest, reddest site on the internet, BigRedBarrel.com.
No Last Samurai.
Don't you remember Cocktail, the cocktail game, where you'd have to mix cocktail? I've never seen Cocktail. I just know he's a cocktail bartender, I mean,
yeah,
guy.
That's pretty much it.
Mixologist.
No Rain Man game where you have to count cards in a casino.